would go.
Good morning. We are so happy to be in another Sunday school because we missed on last Saturday because of all the festivities that we had going on. And I know that you all had studied the lessons and everything, but we are so happy to be here today to pick up with our Sunday school lesson. And before we get into this lesson, we're going to have a word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, we come this morning to thank you for your many blessings. We thank you for lying down last night and then early this morning we touched you. And we were able to get up and dress ourselves. And now here we are in the sanctuary, willing and ready to give you praise. We pray that our eyes, our hearts, and our ears will be open to receive your word. And once we receive it, that we will become doers of your word. We pray for all the sick, the bereaved, and the shut-in everywhere. We thank you right now in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Now, our lesson today, we have been studying on faith for the past month or two. And we are continuing to talk about faith. And today, our lesson is titled Salvation for All Who Believe. Now, we know or we have heard that Jesus came and he said his prayer is that none should perish, right?
Amen.
So he wants all of us to be saved. Now, in today's lesson, we're coming from Romans, the 10th chapter, verses 5 through 17. Now, Paul's letter to the church in Rome was to both the Jews and the Gentiles. Amen?
Amen.
The Jew and Gentile Christians. He wanted them to know and to understand that their salvation was through faith in Jesus Christ, and not in their work.
Amen.
Now, we have been talking about how can we get saved or how do we get this faith. And we found out a few weeks ago when we talked about Father Abraham that it does not come through work. So we must understand that we cannot work our way into heaven. Amen.
Amen.
It is not by work, but it is through our faith in Jesus Christ. Now, this lesson talks about how the faith takes root in a person's life, and also how faith is transmitted from person to person. Amen? So, with that, if anybody else has anything that you want to say in regards to introducing this lesson. Now, let me just say this. Israel had, they could not understand that it was not by the laws that Moses had written that they would be saved, right? That was their deepest thinking. So when you look at the first verse in the 11th, in the 10th chapter,
all right,
it says, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved."
Mm-hmm.
He wanted them to be saved. This is Paul's people.
Mm-hmm.
So they still had it in their mind that it was by the law that they could be saved. They upheld the law to the letter. Even with all of their upholding the law, that was not their saving grace.
Amen.
Amen. Then he goes on to say, "For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge." They had a zeal, they had the desire, but it was not according to God. It was because of the work and the law. for they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believes. Now, it says that Christ, you get that?
Yes.
Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believes. And as we get further into this lesson, we're going to find out that we have to speak it, we have to hear it, and it has to come from within the heart. Anybody else want to jump in on that before we get into verse 5?
I kind of want to add a little bit to also, the Jews, as you said, they wanted to stick to the law. And the law entailed them believing in God, but they had a problem accepting Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And Paul had such a zeal that he wanted them, like you said, to really get, you know, that their saving grace is by Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't just believe in God.
Right.
And not accept Jesus Christ. So he was going gung-ho with wanting them to understand.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
For what you were saying too about with the law, about the Jews with the law, they set themselves a standard that they themselves could not hold on to.
Mm-hmm.
They're saying that everybody got to do this and everybody got to follow this, but they can't. And in addition to that, it's supposed to, you know, will show within your heart, the soul within you that is in your heart to be the right type of person. Well, following the law is a type of works, but like they showed them also, like Jesus showed the parables of how with works and how the Pharisees, when they had opportunities to help someone that was lesser than them, they weren't willing to. And if you're God-like and you're supposed to be following the laws, you would help people in need. Like you used the parable about the Good Samaritan, how the Jewish people walked on the other side of the road, that they wouldn't help. Well, I thought about that, that they're supposed to be following everything perfectly, which they can't because nobody can.
Mm-hmm.
Well, then it would be indwelled into your heart to help others. And they didn't because they felt it was like a catch-22. I can't hang around you because you're a sinner, but you need to do the law to come up to me, which is something I can't do myself. So how do you get away from that?
You know, the amazing thing is, to just kind of piggyback on everything that was said, I'm going to hold on to something that I cannot accomplish myself, because I'm going to hold on to the law even though I am falling short of it. And here it is, God has made a way for me, but I'm not going to accept his way through the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm stuck in a position now where I am basically willing to die for what I so-called believe in, even though it does not benefit me at all.
Mm-hmm.
And how many people today have religion without relationship? They are holding on to religion, but they have no relationship with Jesus Christ. They can tell you, you know, it amazed me when people be like, well, you know, the universe. Well, somebody created the universe.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they'll say, well, I don't believe in God, but I believe in a higher being. Well,
right.
None of this makes sense to me. The same way, I'm going to hold on to the law. We're going to be, you know, we believe in works, even though I cannot live up to what the law requires. And here it is, God has made a plan. He has set a plan in motion. So when we get to chapter 10, that's what Paul is dealing with, the fact that here is the plan of salvation that God has for you already.
Mm-hmm.
Because in chapter 9, he's pleading with them because they have rejected the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
righteousness, I mean the righteousness by law and the righteousness by faith. Can someone describe those two? What is the difference between righteousness by law and then righteousness by faith?
Righteousness by law means that I have to live up to every standard of the law in order for me to be able to be considered righteous.
Okay.
Righteous by faith, that's what you said,
mm-hmm.
means that I accept the Son of God. I say the Lord Jesus Savior. That puts me in the right, not just right standard. There you go. So now I'm righteous through my faith in the one who died mm-hmm. and covered all my sins.
Okay.
Because righteousness through the law, I'll never obtain because I can't.
Okay.
I can't live up to what the laws require me to do.
Mm-hmm.
Because I have two natures. I have a spiritual side and a carnal side.
Mm-hmm.
And because I was born with my carnal side, it has had more practice than my spiritual side has.
Okay. Right.
So it shows up more than my spiritual side.
Okay.
And that takes us to Romans chapter 7, where Paul is saying, guess what? I have a nature that I really don't care for.
Mm-hmm.
And every time I'm trying to do my best,
mm-hmm.
it shows up.
Okay.
Amen. Any other comments? Okay, the word of faith is nearer than you think. Which brings us to, before we get there, would you agree that generally we can often do and make things harder than they need to be?
Would you agree with that?
We absolutely make them harder.
Mm-hmm.
It is true that we can make things harder than they need to be when it comes to God saving us.
Amen.
Paul addresses this in our scripture, which takes us to verse 5.
Mm-hmm.
For Moses describes the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which doeth those things shall live by them. And I think we already discussed that, because when Sister Vanessa and Pastor and all of us was talking about it, we have these laws that we are supposed to uphold. And we say, for instance, there is a law. Well, I'm looking at Sister Williams. Now, you got to do this and that and the third, but yet I'm not doing it myself. But we want to uphold those laws. We want others to uphold those laws, and we ourselves are not doing it.
Amen.
Now, we have learned already from Paul that trying to obtain God's righteousness through living the law of Moses is useless. But because in all us, we will fail.
Mm.
Now, Do you remember Jesus' frustration with many of the religious leaders of his days and what he said about them? They tie up heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on the shoulders of others.
Amen. Yeah.
But they themselves are unwilling to lift a finger to move them.
Right.
You can read about that in Matthew chapter 23, I believe it is. Jesus chastened the religious leaders for attempting to put a relationship with God out of reach for the masses of the common people. In contrast, Jesus said, "Come to me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For my yoke is easy and my burdens are light." Jesus was saying to ordinary people that a vital relationship with God was within reach. It's within reach. It's not far out there that we can't reach it. I think Jesus would affirm the direction Paul is going in our scripture lesson. But in verse 6,
Anybody else?
Can I jump into this?
Yes, ma'am.
When we were talking about the law, and I think we have to keep in mind that the law was not useless. Mm-hmm. It really did serve a
right.
purpose, mm-hmm. and that was for them and us to see ourselves and our shortcomings,
mm-hmm.
you know, to show that we weren't perfect. So
mm-hmm.
I guess everything, I guess every law has a purpose, right?
It does.
Can I just piggyback on what you just said? Paul is letting him know the law was not meant to save us,
right.
but to show us our guilt
mm-hmm.
and that we needed a Savior.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the law was about. And if you look at Romans chapter 7, I believe it's, I wrote it down, 12 and 16, you know, he showed that the law is perfect.
Uh-huh.
You know,
mm-hmm.
he says it more than once in those passages.
Mm-hmm.
He said that the law is perfect. So the law points to us, to show us, you know, that we are lost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's
right. You know, and that's why I said, after I said that the law was useless, then I said, because we will fail.
Mm-hmm.
We can't keep it. We will fail, you know. And it goes back to what both of you have just said. Amen.
Then they say, if someone could attain righteousness by keeping the law, it would mean that they had perfect obedience. But Jesus Christ was the only one who perfectly obeyed the law of God. So he was qualified to be a sinless sacrifice that all who believe would be made the righteousness of God in him. In 2 Corinthians 5:21. So you can't have perfect obedience. That's why, by keeping the law. You know.
Okay, anybody else? Verse 6 and 7, I'm going to put those together.
All right.
But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise, say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring up Christ again from the dead. Now, when it comes to the righteousness that comes from faith, a relationship with God moves within reach. You don't have to say in your heart that I have to work my way to heaven to bring Christ down.
Amen.
You're not working, you know, your way to heaven to bring him down, or to dig your way down into the deep to bring him up from the dead. Because that has already been done. The righteousness that comes from faith, the journey of faith, is not an impossibility. It's not a long journey. Have you ever heard it said that the journey of faith is 18 inches? Have you heard that before? And why I say 18 inches is because that's the distance from your head to your heart. 18 inches.
Right.
Amen.
Each.
And that just shows you how close faith is to us. That you don't have to work your way to get it. It's already there. You just, as we go through this lesson, you're going to see it. Because in mm-hmm. verse 8, it said, but what does it say? But what says it? The word is nigh thee. And I think that word nigh thee in this lesson is saying near thee.
Yes.
The word is near thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach.
Amen.
Amen. The word of faith is near you. The word of faith is on your lips. It's in your heart. Paul was not being random in his choice of words. The
the words lips and hearts were deliberately chosen, because you have to speak it and you have to believe it. Amen.
Amen.
Anybody?
For this one, like this, these particular verses that he was using, Paul had an act of going back. He knew that there were people who would grew up knowing the Torah, the Hebrew word, they knew what Moses had written down. So like in this one, he took back from Deuteronomy 30 chapter 12 through 14, where it says, it's not in heaven that you should call who are saying into heaven to bring it to us, nor is it beyond the sea. I'm just reading parts of 12 and 13, but 14 says, but the word is very near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that you will do it. And throughout this lesson, he used Deuteronomy, he used Isaiah, to pull, in essence, he's saying, these are things that you all knew. You knew that this was coming, you knew from this, but you all are choosing still to be so zealous. He used the word zealous, which is funny because Paul was zealous in his way of doing things too. When he said they're so zealous to follow something that you can't achieve. But if I use the words that you all are familiar with, the scriptures that you all are familiar with, maybe that'll speak to your heart and hearts and make you all listen to what you're supposed to do. So he showed that they had the instruction there before them, but they didn't want to use it.
And that's part of the reason why he says the word is nigh thee. You don't have to go and look for it because it's here now. We have to realize that where we are right now, there is indwelling. So the Holy Spirit lives in us, which gives us the words to say. The word is nigh thee. It's on their lips. It's in their heart. So you ain't got to go up in heaven. You ain't got to go into the abyss. And what Paul is, when he goes back and uses Deuteronomy, and I don't want to get ahead of the lesson for what we get ready to go, but he is showing that it has been not only spoken and prophesied all throughout the Old Testament of this time right here, the Messiah. Old Testament prophesied about the Messiah coming, and Paul is basically saying the person that you've been hearing about is the person that's here. Person that you reject is the one we are talking about right now. You no longer have to work for what you believe because the work has already been done for you.
No gymnastics.
Law that they read and recited, it pointed to Jesus, but they couldn't see that. Why couldn't they see that? Is that because they didn't believe in Jesus? They just thought he was just an ordinary prophet? Or
a little bit of both.
Okay.
It's kind of like today when you see non-believers, when you meet an atheist that does not believe in Jesus Christ, does not believe in God, does not believe in the Holy Spirit. But yet, they benefit the blessings of God every day because they have life in their body.
Right.
It's like, oh God, it's like you work on a job with the Jehovah's Witness. They don't celebrate Christmas. But whatever off day you get for the holiday, guess what? They accepting that off day as well. They ain't saying, oh, no, I don't believe in it, so I'll be at work, give me some work to do. No, they going to stay at home the same way you are. So you can, so there are people that can see the hand of God. We can walk outside and see God's work, just living in heaven. But yet and still, they reject because that's just a part of who they are.
Okay. Well,
And that's why they were fighting so hard to try to work out salvation. Mm-hmm. And here it is, it's hard to accept it. Like I said, I'm trying not to move ahead. Mm-hmm. But it's hard to accept a so-called new law.
Mm-hmm. Amen. That is so good that we can all get clarification, because many times you know what you're trying to say, but to put it in words that somebody else can understand is a little bit hard. So that's why we're glad to have Pastor here with us, so he can kind of break these things down. Sister Vanessa, you had something?
I was saying, we know what we're talking about earlier, and actually that Diane too, how sometimes you look at somebody and you say, is that so-and-so? I remember when they were drinking, they were out on the street or whatever. The people grew up with Jesus and they saw him. And there's a scripture, and you all have helped me out with that one, where they say, is this not the carpenter's son, the brother and sister of so-and-so? They didn't want to believe that he was in their midst, that he grew up around them, and that this was someone that they knew. They felt like it was somebody that was going to come down, you know, that they could see and from heaven, and you might maybe on a white horse or something. They didn't believe our ways are not God's ways. That's not how God chose to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they didn't want to accept them from that people get along.
Okay, so where are we? Verse 9, and I've been waiting to get to this verse. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. And verse 10, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now that brings me to Sister Williams and I was just discussing a few weeks ago about when people join church. And in this day and time, pastors do not ask them, and I'm not talking about you, Pastor Lyons, I'm
yes,
just
right.
saying.
You're right.
Pastors and preachers in general. You know, when we were growing up, this statement, these two verses, 9 and 10, you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart. Pastors used to say that to people when they come up and they join church. But you don't hear that too much in this day and time. So it makes you wonder. But confessing with your lips is a reference to a public profession of the Christian faith. Making your profession of faith public is vitally important and necessary. Don't when you make a confession, you want everybody to know about it, you know? I mean, that can be guilty or innocent. I'm just using that as an example. Guilty or innocent. If you're innocent, you want everybody to know it.
Amen.
Same thing applies with your profession of your faith in Jesus Christ. You should want everybody to know that I believe in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, you know, because they are all one. So you dare not, however, give up lip service to the public profession of faith. You must also believe what you say in your heart. Then notice how lips and heart are both needed in this instance. You got to speak it and you got to know it in your heart. When you announce with your lips what you believe in your heart, you are becoming accountable to others for what you believe. And Pastor Lyons, I saw that look on your face, and I know you had something to say when I was
absolutely.
Talking
you about it.
I'm teasing now.
But you know what? The church of old, this was what they always quoted whenever you had revival. They always read Romans 10, always. That's the standard. That's the plan of salvation. And I think where we are now is, rather than me quote it to you, because notice Paul says, confession is made with the mouth. That means I need to hear that person make that confession, that they are now believers, that they now receive Jesus Christ, their Lord and Savior. And I believe sometimes you have heard me say afterwards, that as long as you confess with your mouth, believe in your heart, thou shalt be saved. But the person, rather than me coerce them into saying it, they have to say it for themselves. Yes, ma'am.
I wouldn't consider that coercion, because they may be new to the faith and they don't know what to say. So you're just asking them, or say it's like me. We're just asking them, do you believe that Jesus Christ is God's son?
And I do that.
No, I'm just saying in general, right. You know, because as Sister Kane said, it starts with our heart first. It's a heart change. And once that heart change, we start speaking it out of our mouth. And that's all.
Well, it depends on the person. And what I mean by that is, it depends on the age bracket. If they're younger, then sometimes I kind of ask questions. But if they're older, they have experienced enough to when now they can say what has happened to them.
That, because that's not what the scripture
is.
It's just saying that confession needs to be made. So it's no age. I just believe when a person come down and they want to join the body of Christ, they've already felt it in their heart and they believe.
Okay, so then tell me what you felt. Tell me what you felt.
I can't tell you if you don't ask me.
No, that's what I'm saying. That's why I give them the mic to say, okay, let you tell your testimony right now, what just happened to you.
But a lot of people are afraid to speak.
If they're afraid to speak, then they shouldn't be afraid to speak. Okay, let them have. If they are, let's say he's a non-believer, this is the first time coming. If he doesn't want to confess, then yeah, I will go through the steps. But if he's somebody who's already a believer and he's coming here, now I'm just allowing him to tell, you know, whatever his testimony is, why he's coming to New Bethel, if he's already saved, if he's already been baptized, you know, that's the standard that I take. Now, I can't speak for nobody else. I mean, what you're saying is not wrong, but what I'm saying is, that's the standard that I try to take. If you're a new believer that has never, you know, been church before, then yes, I am going to try to help you, but I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I am going to say, you know, do you believe? You know, I'm going to take you just like I would a 5-year-old.
Okay.
You understand what I'm saying? Because I need to hear this, and we need to hear it.
So what about when you give the person a mic, and they start going when they was down south, and came back up here, and they never said nothing about anything? What
do
they believe?
But now I'm going to ask you, well, what is it? Okay, y'all get off these paths.
Now, and that brings us to another question that came to mind. It's not really a question, but then it is a question. Now, I know all of you all have known and you have heard, because it happened right here at New Bethel a few times under different administrations. They'll take a person in the office. And this lesson here is telling us that you have to confess it before the body of Christ. I was reading that somewhere. It says, when something is kept to yourself, it remains tentative in your spirit. Once you are ready to say it out loud, that which was tentative rises to the new level of confidence. Now, which goes back to what you and Sister Williams was discussing. If a person gets up out of his seat and he walks up front, to me that is saying that already he has felt something within his heart. And he should be able to be now ready to speak it out to the Christian congregation. Because it comes from the heart, And the lips are supposed to be able to speak out what he is feeling in his heart. Amen?
Amen. I agree with that.
All right.
According to this, that is what, you know, Paul is saying. So back to what I was saying. They take a person in the office and say that they were too shy to come out into the congregation. Now, I always said, and I never got to this pastor on this, but Matthew, y'all can help me, Matthew 33, 34, somewhere, mm-hmm. where it says, if you are ashamed to own me before men, I would be ashamed to own you before my Father, which is in heaven.
That's not the same.
I mean, I'm just saying, when they take a man in the office, it's like they're being ashamed.
No. Okay, let me help you, because let me give you a great example. Okay. You have a person who is just naturally shy to get up in front of the church,
mm-hmm.
but yet they want to accept.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not going to be one that says, no, you got to get up, because now who am I to make that judgment? And this person says, okay, because I'm so shy, then I just want to accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I'll just leave and go back home. And then you have a person who is at home who cannot come to church. And yet I go to their house and take them in.
Mm-hmm.
What is the difference? Because you make one person have to stand and announce it for the church, then you should make the other person as well. But they can't do it.
Mm-hmm.
And this person, in their own, I mean, because we deal with people deal with so much anxiety and all of that. Mm-hmm. And I'm not trying to give them that excuse. But, I mean, we see now where some people just do not, cannot, and will not go up front in front of a lot of people and do anything. And I don't see it being wrong to take them in, because you're doing it before witnesses as well. Yes, ma'am.
I think what has happened here is, again, you know, we have man-made customs and rules and stuff, because if you're looking at the scripture, from my understanding, it does not say that when we accept Jesus Christ as our Savior, we have to be in the body, in a church, before a group of people.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way we're used to doing it. That's our custom. So, yeah, when you first hear that somebody's taken in an office, that's crazy. They were just in church. Why didn't they walk to the chair and sit down? But then when you get the whole picture of it, is it doesn't have to be like that. Because I can, like you say, be on my dying bed and can't get to church. And I believe and I accept, if it's one person there, that's all that matters. Because this, first of all, God is my witness. So, and that's why I keep saying we get so stuck. We have tunnel vision. And I'm just trying to get beyond that, because it's not for me the way that I always see it and the way that I think. And I just want to move to a different place in my understanding of God's word.
Thank you for that. Let me show you something. When Paul gets released from jail, him and Silas, they go to the jailer's house.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't bring him to church.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible said that he went to his house and his household was saved. They didn't bring them to church.
Mm-hmm.
It was done in private,
mm-hmm.
to your point.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to get away from the tradition as we see it.
Mm-hmm.
And that Matthew scripture is talking about denial of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I saw something that resonated with me.
Yes.
It was a young lady. She used to play on one of the little sitcoms, and she was saying the problem with people is, she said, we are the problem because we misrepresent God. She said, there's nothing wrong with God.
No.
He's perfect.
Mm-hmm.
She said, but the people who claim to be Christians, we misrepresent God, which turns people off from God.
That's true.
By looking at us.
Yes, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I believe that.
That's where I want to move to. I just want him to move me to a different place. You know, because if I represent him have to be like him.
Amen.
I can't stay in myself. You know, so now I'm looking at scripture. Oh,
what are some of the ways that the church misrepresent God? What are some of the ways that
just our own traditions? I mean, just like Paul started off by saying they have a zeal. That means they're enthusiastic. You know, they have this passion, but it's not according to knowledge. Meaning that we have to study and understand God's thoughts because He has given us His Spirit. So when I understand God's thoughts and God's ways and God's will, God's plan, then I start operating His way and not mine. Absolutely. They were saying that you can't be saved if you go in the back room.
Okay.
All right.
Good dialogue. This is why we need Sunday school, and this is why we need Bible study.
Amen.
Because there are others who can point you in the right direction when you get off track.
Amen.
So all of you who are listening via Facebook, YouTube, whatever it is, just remember that many times we can get off track.
Amen.
But thank God there's always somebody to bring us back. With that, we're going to move on to verse 11, 12, and 13. Okay. For the scripture says, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen.
No one who believes in him will be put to shame by being refused. We have noted in previous Sunday school lesson how Jews and Greek came to Christ in the New Testament church from different starting points and how they may have had different issues to work through. And we all have different issues to work through, which was just stated. But those distinctions pale against the desire of the Lord to be the Lord of all, and to be generous to all who call upon him. Mm-hmm. Now, Paul quotes Joel 2:32 when he says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
No one is left out. Everyone who calls.
Amen.
Calling on the name of the Lord is a beautiful way to characterize a person's first turn toward the Lord.
Amen.
Have you ever called out for help?
Yes, Lord.
Have you ever called out in desperation?
Yes, Lord.
Have you ever called out to be attended to?
Amen.
Have you ever called for recognition?
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever called out in the silence just to see if anyone was there to hear you?
Amen.
Any of these times you called back?
Come on now.
Do you happen to remember the very first time you prayed to God when you were by yourself?
Mm-hmm.
And although it felt new, it felt so natural.
Amen.
Amen. Call out to Him and He will answer. And I think you sang the song, I called on the Lord and I got an answer.
Come on,
Amen.
Amen.
Do you? Do you remember calling on the name of the Lord one day and you were ushered into an intimate experience?
Yes, Lord.
Amen. I know I do. Because of the generosity of the Lord, saving faith is within reach. We can reach it, you all.
Yes.
We ain't got to work it. We can reach it. It's there for us. All we got to do is call on His name.
Amen. Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Anybody?
Come on, how you doing?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
You're a priest.
You got to get up
in your mouth.
Yeah,
Lord.
Since no one is beyond the reach of God's love and grace, no one is beyond that reach. Mm-hmm. So, and like she said for Job 2:32, it said, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You know, so Paul was really doing some good teaching to this church, and he was really trying to get them to realize that there's no difference between the Jew and the Gentile in God's eyesight. You know, they separate us, and we separate ourselves from other races and other people and all of that. But God doesn't see that like that. So that's why we have to come together with each other. You know, because God has no respect for person. And Paul was really trying to get that over to these people.
Okay. Verse 14 helps us out with that. Okay. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring good glad tidings of good things.
Can I just jump in?
Go right ahead.
What we see right here is Paul quoting facts, because the Bible says that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. But the problem Paul is having is the gospel has become stagnant because the Jews who do not believe in Jesus Christ as the Messiah, who is the Word of God. So therefore, if I do not believe that he is, how am I going to now teach it or spread the gospel? So he's showing now, how can you call on somebody that you never believed because they didn't believe? And how can you call somebody who you've never heard? But they have heard. Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know, he is, you mentioned he's passionate. He's passionate because he realizes that they are part of his family because he is Jew. He's a Jew himself. He was a Pharisee as well. So he was brought up knowing the law. He was brought up, but he experienced something that they had. On the road to Damascus, he experienced Jesus Christ himself. And so now he's passionate because he wants them to experience the same thing that he had. If you go back, I believe it's in chapter 9, he talks about the fact that he would be willing to be cut off that they may receive salvation. That's how much he desired. And so when you see here and here, he's talking about, you know, y'all should have been carrying the gospel. Y'all should have been the ones teaching this gospel. But guess what? They haven't been.
Can I read this here out of my book? It says, some seem to think that those who had not heard about Jesus would not be held accountable for what they didn't know about him. That's where all the teachers and the preachers and all come in. At first, it may seem that Paul agreed with this and was urging more to commit themselves to sharing the gospel with others. But the Jews had heard about Jesus through his own words or the words of others. They therefore had no excuse for rejecting him.
That's it.
God continues to reveal himself to those who don't seek him and holds his hands of redemption out to those who are disobedient or obstinate. So, yeah, it goes back to what you were saying. I just wanted to read it. It kind of took me.
Pastor, you done?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, verses, where are we, 15?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
No, shall they preach except they be sent, as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. And it has a reference to Isaiah chapter 52, verse 7. Yes, ma'am.
And I have a question. Does verse 15 just pertain to preachers?
I wouldn't think. I don't think so. Because because when it, I don't know, I may be wrong on this one too, but in Matthew chapter 28, where he gave the Great Commission, go lead into all the world, so it couldn't be. I think it was all of us.
Absolutely. Preaching is just sharing the gospel. You know, and all of us, it's just like, if you notice, I always say we all have been called. So we all have been called into this body, and we all have been commissioned to do the same thing. Share the gospel.
So that's just another misunderstanding of that scripture. Just like, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm.
Yeah.
Because, and that goes on, I mean, to let us know that everybody, I mean, we're not all called for the same thing.
Right.
Some of us are encouragers, some of us are equippers, some of us are teachers.
That's what the Bible tells us.
Some of us are preachers, apostles, teachers, all of those things. So, and we all have to use what we are given, whatever capacity we fall into, we are to use it. Whether you are called and sent to be an equipper of the saints for the work of the ministry, or you are called to be one of those saints that equip and do the ministry. Listen to your calling and go where you are being sent. Now, last two verses, and we're almost out of time. 16 and 17. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Some people refuse to receive the good news. And it goes back to that word that Pastor Lyons and Sister William used a few minutes ago. God does not coerce our response. God desires that we respond freely. His offer of salvation. God patiently waits for us to say yes to his offer. As we share our faith with other people, it is important that we do not burn our bridges if they refuse the first time. Which means that if you're talking to me about it and I don't accept it, don't burn the bridge. Keep on until, you know, you get me to see the point of view. And I'm not saying browbeat me, you know, but at some given point, you're going to be given that opportunity so you can bring it up again. We would talk about that again, but just don't throw me out there and just leave me, you know, say, okay, she ain't gonna give me, so I just give up on her. You know, that's not what he would have us to do. Anybody?
Like that last verse that says, so then faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Mm-hmm. It say, here he answers the question saying, so then faith cometh by hearing. The lack of hearing was one of the Jews' failures. For people to come to faith in Jesus Christ, they have to hear the message that produces faith. This message is found in the gospel, or as Paul said here, the word of God. So in other words, the word, so it's a faith coming by hearing, right? So those Jews, they said, had a lack of hearing. That was one of their failures. Because they couldn't hear the word. You think God stopped their ears up?
I think they heard the word. They heard it. They just didn't want to receive
they
it.
They
had heard it. They had heard the word.
Right.
They knew about Jesus Christ. They knew about his death, burial, and resurrection. Mm-hmm. Their heart was stopped up.
Okay.
That's what Paul did not
say. Stopped up.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's just why
my
sister came telling me the son is yellow.
Right.
I don't want to believe what she said, but the sun is actually yellow.
Wow. That's tough.
Okay, Pastor, wrap this up.
Well, I'll read this here while you get your thoughts together. And it says, verse 16 says, not everyone believed the good news, even if they heard it. So that kind of covers what we were just saying about the Jews. They heard it. They just did not believe it because they felt like Jesus was teaching, say, a new law by their standards. So they just didn't believe it. And so many times we have people today in our life right now that hear the gospel preached and yet do not receive it. And so unless at some point Christ comes in your heart, you will be lost forever. And that's the same way they were. That's why Paul was so passionate about trying to pull them in, was because he realized that if they don't receive, they don't receive this message, they will be lost forever. And he is trying to show them that salvation has already been laid out, planned out. If you go to Hebrews, I wrote it down somewhere. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 6 and 6 through 8. Read that in your leisure. God had already appointed this new way to salvation through Jesus Christ. Hebrews 8, 6 through 8. So today we are in a place, yes sir.
What I want to ask is that, but is it because people, how can I say, they choose not to accept the message, or is it because that they pick and choose what they want to follow, what they don't want to follow?
Absolutely. I mean, and that God has given us all that freedom to choose what we want to be. That's why it's a faith walk. When you read out Ephesians chapter 2, I believe it's 8 through 9, he talks about that we have been saved by grace through faith. You know, we have to choose to believe what we hear. You know, somebody can tell you something. Sister William just made a great analogy. She said, Sister Kane can tell her that the sun was what, blue?
Yellow.
And you guys said, no, it's orange. You have to choose to believe. Even without going out looking, you have to believe what you just heard. That's what faith is about. So people choose just what you just said, what they believe when they hear it. Like some people, they'll doubt the truth, but they'll believe a lie in a minute.
In a
And the lie can sound so outlandish, but yet they'll grab that and get on the phone. But I'm so grateful today that God had a plan of salvation for all of us. And we have received that plan through faith by believing in his son. And that's all he was asking them to do, was believe in Jesus Christ, his son. And I'm so glad that the son lived the plan by going to Calvary's cross. Sustain anything? Can we close the prayer?
Nope.
All right. Thank God for all of our teachers. Great discussion today. Even though sometimes it sounds like we be arguing, no, we just be discussing. That's how we do. That's how family do things.
Right.
And at the end, we still love each other. Apologize for the noise at the beginning. We are filling up the pool for baptism on tomorrow. So that was the noise, but we got it taken care of. Thank God for all of them. Thank God for you. And we're going to close out in prayer. We have ran over our time a little bit, but it's a great discussion. Father, we thank you today. We bless you, God. We give you honor and glory. Thank you for the plan of salvation that was made to all believers. And God, I pray today, Lord, that there's anybody in my family or any of teachers' family that are unbelievers, God, that they would accept the plan of salvation, come to know you as their Lord and Savior. And then, God, just devote and commit their lives to you. And then, Father, those that have known you that may have backed away, God, I'm praying, Lord, that you said that by love and kindness have I drawn you. I pray, God, that you said, if you draw nigh to me, I'll draw nigh to you. That you will, Father, bring them back, God. Lord, we thank you for what you did on last week. We thank you for your covering, how you covered us all week. God, we lift up right now Sister Diane Crocker and her family, God, and the passing of her sister, God. We know you can be strength, God, in the midst of our weakness, God. We know that you can lift up a bow down here. We pray right now, Lord, that you would meet her right where she is, God. And whatever she needs, God, you would restore her, God.
Yeah.
Father, we thank you, Lord. We ask that you go with us and we leave this place, but never from your presence. In Jesus' name we pray, and we all say it, amen.
Amen.